Mikkelsen. He is a CEO of Ellegaard, Gottingen, Minipig in Denmark. He is a veterinarian and he has done his MBA degree. So he's also a management guy. And he's going to talk about the Gottingen Minipigs in biomedical research. Lars? Okay, he's getting ready.
Yep. So at least I won't be talking all the time. So of course also I want to thank the organizers. I'm really pleased to be back in India. It's really great being here. So thanks a lot to you, BJ, for inviting me. So I think you might think that we are going to talk about minipigs, and of course we are. But we actually also are going to talk about the triage principles. And you will definitely see that during my slide. So first of all, we are the Danish breeder of the Gottingen minipigs. So we provide the minipigs almost all over the world. We'll get back to that one. They have an extreme high health status. They also have a very similar genetic standard. So actually disregarding if you buy the minipig from us in Denmark, if you buy the minipigs from Marshall, our partner in the US, or if you buy the minipigs from Wuchung in Japan, you will get similar animals. And jumping right into the triage principles, we heard a nice presentation from Catherine stating more or less the same, that refinement is also about, and reduction is also about choosing the right species. So one of our very fundamental statement, our vision statement, is that we believe you should always consider minipigs, pigs, whenever you have to choose your large animal species. So when you think about using the dog, the non-human primate, or the pig, the minipigs, be aware that you should use your scientific knowledge and in that way make sure that your choice will be the best one. So I can see these are really hard to read, but this is the European legislation also stating that the choice of method, also being the choice of species, should always be selected to give you the best results. So again, coming back to the 3R principles about refinement and also reduction. So an overall reduction in the number of animals we are using to get the best ever data. It has been stated in many presentations, and again, I can see it's really hard to see this one, but this review paper is also stating that the choice of species should always be considered whenever you have to choose between the three main species I told you about. It's the same if you go into the guidelines. This is an example from one of the FDA guidelines, the OECD guidelines, also stating that safety evaluation programs should include the choice of the most relevant species. And also even clearly stating that if you choose the wrong one, then of course you might get wrong results, and in that way work against the 3R principles. And you can discuss, is that what we do? If you look at this big survey up here, it was a survey done over a 10-year period where you see that almost 10,000 studies going into the clinic were evaluated, and actually only 10% of them succeeded. So this means that 9 out of 10 times something went wrong in the process of using animals to go into the clinic. So in my mind, we are doing something wrong because the models can't be predictable if 9 out of 10 never succeed, never go into man as the intention of doing all the studies. So again, one of my messages to you is really always consider what to choose, what species to choose, what method to choose. And we heard these nice presentations this morning. Always go back and reevaluate what you do because you can only learn from it. The reasons for failure, well, this is also an updated overview. I remember when I was very young, maybe like 25 years ago, we had a safety issue, we had a tox issue in many of the clinical trials. Nowadays, you simply see that at least half of them are lacking efficacy. So it means when you go into man, when you do your clinical trials, you see absolutely no effect. So the drug, you are spending maybe 10 years trying to evaluate in your animal studies, simply has no effect in man. So again, something is definitely wrong. So that was maybe a very long introduction. And now we'll actually jump back in time, back to the 60s, where the Gottingen minipigs were created, of course, in Gottingen in Germany. So what they did in Germany was that they mated the Minnesota minipig with the Vietnamese pot-bellied pigs, and the outcome was those pigs you see on your right-hand side. And what you even clearly can see is that these animals, they have different colors. Some are black, some are brown, some are spotted. and that was definitely not what they wanted. So what they did was to made this offspring with a farm pig, a German farm pig, and then we got the Gottingen mini pig we know of today. So a normally pigmented pig, not a dwarf, but just a very small pig. And this is what they look like today. They were pretty smart in Germany. They also knew that by using the Vietnamese pot-bellied pigs, first of all, they would get a very little pig, but they would also get a pig with an extreme high fertility. And from the Minnesota mini pigs, you got the really, really nice temper you see in the Gottingen pigs today. And of course, you got the white skin from the German land-raised pigs. So as I already told you, we have three major breeding facilities in the world. We have the one in Denmark, supplying mainly the European market and Korea. We have one in the US in collaboration with Marshall Bioresources, supplying the US and Canada. And we have a facility in Japan, supplying Japan and Taiwan. All of them are ALEC accredited, and that's definitely the way we want to go forward. If you want to enter India or if you want to enter China, all the facilities should be run according to the guide and to the ALEC recommendations. This is how the facility in Denmark looks like. So we have two distinct breeding units. We have approximately 3,500 animals in their colony every day, divided into the two big barriers you see on your right and on your left. We are approximately 40 employees in Denmark, and of course supplying all the users, mainly the CROs, but also the pharma companies and the universities. This is how our pigs are housed in Denmark, in the Danish facility. You see the really nice pens, solid flooring. You see they have hay and straw, and they have different types of enrichment. And of course, they are all group housed, apart from the breeding boars that won't be group housed due to the aggressivity between the males. The barrier, the facility is a very sealed barrier facility, meaning that whatever you introduce needs to be autoclaved, decontaminated, or somehow cleaned before it can enter. Of course, the staff needs to shower. Everything is HEPA filtered, the air coming in. We have an overpressure, so in case something would go in, it will definitely get out again. And of course, we do the health monitoring according to the LASA guidelines. We do that not only in Europe, but also in Japan and in the US. So this is a photo from our research barrier. It's also a bit hard to see. It was a barrier we set up a year ago. So now we can have animals on different diets. We can induce obesity. We can induce different diseases. We can do surgery. And we can deliver animals to you directly with permanent catheters, telemetric devices, or things like that. And we can also now offer you transgenic customized breeding of the mini pigs. So again, I think this is really hard to see. This is the surgical suite. These are easier to see, again, what the facility looks like in Denmark. This is from the research unit, and these are pigs waking up from surgery. Again, a few photos. We focus a lot on education and training, meaning that you can come to us, you can get dedicated training, or we can come to you. If you, for the first time, buy the animals, we often go to you. We train your staff in handling the animals and in the procedures you will be doing on the animals, again, to ensure you that you get the best results and having the animal welfare highlighted. So for the next, like, I think 2 minutes, you will see this film. This is a pregnant sow in the weaning unit. So we take the sows into the farrowing unit, of course, a week before farrowing, and then she stays for 4 weeks with her offspring. So that one is definitely going to give birth pretty soon. You saw she was trying to create a nest. There you see the piglets. In average, we get 8 piglets in a litter. And the sows are pregnant for 115 days. Now the piglets are weaned. So again, they're weaned when they're 4 weeks, divided into males and females. And staying in this climate controls unit for a good month before we take them into the sales unit. You can also see some of the enrichment. This is an old towel. They love whatever they can manipulate, and everything related to food is really what they prefer. So this is a group of pregnant sows. So as soon as the sows are, when the piglets are weaned, the sows will actually go into heat 5 days later, then they are mated naturally, and then they are housed in groups with other sows. Again, some enrichment, big ball. We have these, whatever they are called, pyramids, trapezes, whatever. You see the hay hacks with the hay and straw, the metal chains, and we have these rubber pipes they use a lot for biting and playing around. Okay, so let's skip the rest. Anyhow, so why the Gottingen minipig and why not the other minipigs? What you can clearly see up here is that the Gottingen minipigs are quite smaller than some of the, at least American competitors and the Asian minipigs as well. So you will see when they're a year old, they're typically weighing 20 kilos, 25 kilos. When they are 5 months, being the age where you most normally use them for tox studies, they will be 8 to 10 kilos. So pretty small, a little bit bigger than a typical beagle, but more or less the same size. And also the good thing is that they have that normally pigmented skin. There are problems, but at least if you do dermal studies, it's definitely not a good idea to have a pig or a mini pig with a black or brown or spotted hair color. So this is the weight chart. So again, the typical age where the animals are fully mature is these 4 or 5 months, weighing 8 to 10 kilos, and the time where they typically are used for research. So what are they used for? I only have 20 minutes, so it's going to be super brief. But the first and the most common use was the dermal studies. It's fully accepted by all the regulatory authorities that the pig skin is very similar to human. And if you could have seen this slide over here to the right, you could see that histologically, human skin and pig skin is extremely similar. And for the same reason, it is stated in several guidelines that whenever you do dermal study, you should really consider using pigs or mini pigs, being so similar in the characteristics of the skin. And it is easy, you will see if this will work. I think it will. Then you can see how you can apply your topical ointment to the pigs. So these has been clicker trained, target trained. So you see the pig here will follow the stick, run up to this box where you can also weigh them. And then it will be applied. They do everything for food. They love food. And of course, they need to be on a restricted diet. If not, they will be weighing like 120 kilos. We have seen that in some of the obesity studies. And they actually put on they can easily put on 100% of their weight within 2 to 3 months if you just feed them unlimited. But you see how easy it is. He's just eating and eating. They put on the ointment, and then they put on the bandage to keep everything in place. So there it's applied, still eating and eating. We have some nice video clips. You won't see them today. You can maybe see them if you want to speak to me, where you do the same with the nasal application. So you can see the pig is standing totally still, and you can apply your nasal drop into the nostrils of the pig, and they don't care as soon as they get a reward afterwards. Let's go on. So again, a few more examples where the pigs are used. We see lots of use within ocular research. We see lots of use within cardiovascular research, gastrointestinal. Again, the nasal cavity is actually very similar. Maybe you wouldn't believe that, but it actually is. We even see that the mini pigs now are used for cancer studies, different CNS studies, and a lot of them are used for juvenile studies. So just one more example. So actually, the eye of the pig is very similar to the eye of man. So the anatomy, the absorption of the drug candidate, and the physiology is extremely similar to man. And also, it's extremely easy to use the minipig. So if you lift the minipig like you see over here, they actually look at you. I think the problem sometimes if you use dogs is that they typically will close their eyes and the head will be like all over. But the pigs, they actually, like that one, looks at you. So we have been told it's extremely easy to use them because they are so friendly, and again, yeah, they're looking at you and you're looking at the eye, so it works really, really, really fine. Another way to work with the pigs are by using these slings. So you will actually see they sit totally still. You can train them to sit in a sling within 5 to 10 minutes. That's it. Just be calm, be close to the pig the first time, then they will relax. And also, always remember that they prefer to be hanging. So I think if you do the same with dogs, they prefer to be standing on a platform. But the pigs are much more quiet if they are like hanging in this hammock. And of course, you need to make sure that they have the right size. So if the pigs is growing, you need bigger slings. The good thing about the pig, again, in cardiovascular research is that if you compare, like here, the mini pig, the dog, and the monkey, you will see that the heart rate and the blood pressure is more similar between mini pig and man than between monkey and dog and man. So again, one of the things to consider if you're doing cardiovascular, to maybe consider that the mini pig could be a good choice. There are lots of different models. One of those is the infarct models. You can induce it by many ways. You can do it with ligation, or you can even do it with different types of chemicals. And the good thing you will see is that you see the same ECG changes in the mini pig as you see in the man. So again, a model to consider. And of course, type 2 diabetes. I used to work for Novo Nordisk for many years. We used tons, and they still use tons of mini pigs for the diabetes research, for the reason that you can do all the same tests as the test you do in man. And you will also see that you can induce diabetes with streptozocin, and then you will see the same changes as you see in man again, elevated fasted blood glucose and elevated fasted insulin. You can induce it by diets as well. We are doing lots of induction of different types of diabetes in the mini pigs, but be aware, with a diet, they will never ever be insulin dependent. You need to use some chemicals, some drugs, if you want them to be diabetic, but you can definitely have a state of a pre-diabetic state in the mini pigs by diets. And this was what I told you about. This lady over here called the fat lady, she's weighing like 120 kilos, something like that. And what we see with these diet-induced models, again, hypertension, like in man, you see increases in the triglycerides, and you see many more changes that you also see in the human patients being obese or being pre-diabetic. So definitely a good model for obesity, and especially because, again, they love food. Many of the mini pigs now are used for the juvenile studies, so you might know there is a request now from the authorities that all drugs should be tested on babies. And to reflect that situation, lots of these drug candidates are tested in newborn mini pigs. For many reasons, first of all, you get quite a good litter size. Like I said, 8, maybe 10 pigs in 1 liter. You can actually cross-foster them, meaning that if you have 5 sows giving birth at the same time, you can mix the offspring. That's no problem. The sow will take whatever. Again, with the dogs, that's sometimes a little bit problematic. You will also see that the pigs, they grow to adulthood extremely fast. So in this chart up here, you can see that within 4 to 5 months, they will actually go from being newborn to being fully adult. Again, maybe a month quicker than a dog. If you use a non-human primate, you know that they only normally get 1 offspring. So if you wanted to do juvenile studies in the primate, you needed many more animals. Again, 3 R's. And we all know that it takes a primate 2, 3, 4 years to be fully adult. And again, it takes a mini pig 5 months typically. Microsampling possible again. In the newborn, you can inject your drug candidate, or you can even microsample. And we heard nicely about microsampling yesterday and today as well. A much better way than taking these huge amount of blood that we at least used to do in the past. SIP activity, those of you working with drug candidates know how important it is to know your SIP. Your way of the metabolism, the SIP enzyme that will metabolize your drug candidate. Again, an extremely important criteria when you choose your large animal species. So in this chart, and I think you can more or less see it, you will see that if your drug candidate was metabolized by those two, then there would be absolutely no activity in the beagle dog. So if you did a drug study in the beagle dog with one of those candidates, it would be a disaster because you wouldn't see anything. So very shortly to say, you should choose one of those being green up here. They will have the same SIP activity as the SIP activity in man. And again, to be honest, look at it. So here you have a 5 times more activity than you will in man. So of course, if this was your way of metabolizing your drug candidate, you should never use the mini pig. You should then use maybe the monkey or the beagle dog having half the activity and the monkey having twice the activity. So one of those charts, they're extremely important to know if you deal with drug candidates. And this is, you can't see this at all, I can see that, but it's actually showing the same. It's just two papers combining the information. And sorry again, you can't see this as well, but what you can see up here, you can see lots of letters. And this is really just to show you that Minipigs has been used within a huge number of disease areas. So over here you see different names on diseases, it doesn't really matter. Just to show you that they have definitely been used a lot. We know that FDA years ago had evaluated more than 1,000 studies using the Minipig for drugs going to the American market. Again, does it work with the Minipig? Well, it does, at least sometimes. So what you see in this chart is you see a safety evaluation of using the Minipigs comparing with the situation going into man. So actually you saw in 7 out of 7 studies that the efficacy, and you remember from one of my first slides that we had a huge issue with the efficacy. So we actually saw that again, 9 out of 10 drug candidates failed when they did go into the clinic. At least in this survey, you saw that 7 out of 7 actually had efficacy comparing the situation in the Minipig to the man. And you see over here that these 24 studies out of 27, you had a good or acceptable safety evaluation in the Minipig compared to the situation in man. So definitely, in my opinion, you should consider, again, using the Minipigs. You can do all the routes of dosing. This is some data from CITOX Lab in Denmark, where they showed us in hundreds of studies how they dose the animals. And as you can see, you can do whatever type of dosing. You can train the animals to be restrained, or you can put in the permanent catheters if you want to do repeated injections into the Minipigs. Lots of background information is available, and also one of the reasons for maybe choosing the Gottingen Minipigs, we know a lot about their pathological history. They have been used in research for 35 years now. So again, lots of publications around these normal findings in the Minipigs. And this is an example where we, in a huge collaboration with almost all the pharma companies in Europe, did a survey where we looked into excipients and the use in Minipig. So in this paper, you can actually see which excipients works in the Minipig and which excipients doesn't work in the Minipig. Again, very valuable information. So this was really quick, and I know I spoke quick. I know we are extremely late. Soon we will have coffee, I believe. But again, if you want to look into some references, take a look in this really, really big EU project, the Rethink project that was published in 2010. It's available online if you go to the EU webpage, or you can get a copy from Peter or myself later during this meeting. And the last resource I want to show you is the Minipig in Biomedical Research. It's like a Bible in my world, where you also get lots of references to the use of Minipig within lots of disease areas, and good references about housing, enrichment, etc. So really to conclude, I believe that we have a good product, we have a high quality product. Really consider, if you have to choose a species to do your large animal studies, consider the Minipigs. If you need information from us, come back and ask us. We might know, or we know somebody that knows. So really the focus within the company is to go into scientific branding, focus a lot on the disease models. I showed you a few. In the future, focus on the transgenic animals. And of course, we also want to be available in all major R&D markets. We are trying extremely hard to enter the Indian market. We negotiated with your authorities this Friday, and I hope maybe within half a year or so that the Minipigs will be available in India for the research performed in India as well. So thanks a lot.
Thank you, Dr. Wilson, for a nice talk. So now, 2 questions.
That's good.
Yeah. Half a minute. Okay, sir. So nice.
What do you think a reason for not introducing Minipigs in India up till now? In spite of having lots of advantages over dog and non-human primates. It is a wonderful model. In fact, even the data of one animal is appreciated by regulatory authorities. It is so accurate and so authentic and comparable to human cases.
Yeah, so thanks a lot. So what should I answer? I can say we had I think previously we were focusing on the European market and the American market. Then 5 years ago, we entered Japan. And when I joined the company 2-3 years ago, we decided to go into China as well. And then still India was lacking. So from our end, it was like a, I think we at that time point didn't believe we had a huge market share market in India. And I think in the past, there was a big focus on chemical testing more than pharma testing in India, and that was one of the reasons that we didn't go in earlier. Why the other Minipigs not available, I have no clue. But you know, it is actually extremely difficult to get in here. We have been negotiating for a year now. I think we are lucky due to our health standard and also the health standard of Denmark in overall. So
you're very right.
Yeah.
In fact, I visited your facility in 2003.
Okay.
I was also in Novo Nordisk. And I appreciated, I tried to provoke, evoke the interest in using Minipig. But that time, it probably my efforts have gone in vain, in fact. Because somebody is not ready to invest the kind of funds which are needed for this.
Yeah.
In fact, even in an operation theater, you need a crane.
Exactly.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Any questions?
Sorry again.
No questions. So I request Dr. Shikha Yadav to please present the memento. And in this session, we had 4 lectures, Dr. Williams and Dr. Lars. So all lectures were very informative. Now,
thanks.
Please, sir.